With expression for the aircraft kinematics in hand, we can then move on and develop the dynamics relations. So let's start with linear momentum. So we can write Newton's second law in inertial or earth axes as the sum of forces in earth axes. And this force is the aerodynamic force. Plus the aircraft mass times the gravitational acceleration vector, so this net force excludes the aircraft weight, is equal to m du dt. And this neglects changes in the aircraft mass with time, for example, due to fuel burn. Now in body axes, since Fe is T E of Fb, and similarly for all the other quantities in the equation, we can write E of Fb plus M T E G B with M D T. B. In the notes, I go through a detailed derivation here. I'll do this quickly in this lecture video. But basically, the right-hand side of the equation we can simplify as follows. By applying the product rule for the derivative, and then using the definition of the rate of change of the transformation matrix, which is related to the Euler angles, again, we'll use this first term in place. This is just UE, these second terms. And then finally, we look at this. This is a negative cross the earth axis. Now, if we pre-multiply the whole equation by the transformation matrix from the body axes, then we get Fb plus mgb equals m u dot b plus omega b cross u b. And this is basically the angular momentum equation in body axes. For angular momentum, fundamentally in inertial axes, this is the total aerodynamic moment about the center of mass is going to be equal to the time rate of change of the angular momentum. where the angular momentum is the mass moment of inertia tensor times the angular velocity plus the onboard angular momentum from things like rotating propellers, engines, etc. This is the total angular momentum. And this is our inertia tensor, which we discussed briefly last time. Now I'm going to take a detour for a few minutes to give some more information on what this inertia tensor is going to look like. So again, the mass moment of inertia of a rigid body represents its resistance to angular acceleration, and it's analogous to mass for linear momentum. The key difference is that it isn't a scalar or even a vector, but a tensor. We talked about tensors last time, and that it's really just a 3x3 matrix. And an inertia tensor looks like this. Notice that there are 7, 8, 9. All elements appear at first to be distinct. However, while in general each element of the matrix can be different, the mass moment of inertia depends on the point about which it and also the sum of moments are computed. And for the case where a body is symmetric and the axes are oriented along the directions of symmetry, which is often the case for body axes for aircraft, then the off-diagonal terms all become zero. And the inertia tensor becomes a much more manageable looking diagonal matrix. Okay, end of detour. Let's now get back to developing our angular momentum equation. So again, what we want to do is be able to write this in body axes rather than in earth axes. So if we use a transformation matrix, we can do that. And using a similar approach to what we did with angular momentum, we can write this as TEB H dot E plus omega cross H with axes, and then pre-multiplying by the opposite transformation matrix and replacing H B with I B omega B plus little h B gives, using only body axis quantities, and B is I B omega dot B plus omega B cross I B omega B plus H. Which is our angular momentum equation in body axes.